Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Creating Wellbeing and Building Resilience in the Veterinary Profession, A Call to Life by Sonja A. Olson, narrated by Sonja A. Olson. Dedicated to my favorite human who happens to be my husband, Matt, and to all the animals that have been a part of my life's journey, I am deeply grateful. Foreword. Provided by Dr. Vanessa Rolfe, counselor, psychotherapist, and research fellow. When I was 7 years old, we lived on a small hobby farm in a semi-rural area of Victoria, Australia. My parents had just purchased 6 Hereford calves they had planned to raise and then let her sell at the stockyards. I had purchased one too with my pocket money. Her name was Sarah. As the cattle were settling into their new surroundings, I was eager to go and meet our new quote-unquote pets. Unfortunately, my eagerness was not shared by the small herd, and they moved away whenever I approached. I did not, however, give up. I eventually discovered that if I lay still long enough on the ground, they would come to me. I still remember the smell of the grass, the warmth of the summer breeze on my skin, the sound the cattle made as they came over to sniff me, this strange creature lying on their patch of grass. Having these kinds of connections with animals led to feelings of peace and happiness. As you listen to this, you may think of your own early connections with animals. And by reflecting on this, you might see how your decision to move into the veterinary profession may have been shaped by these very experiences. For many, being a veterinary professional is not just what we do. It is a part of who we are. When things go wrong, when we start to question our career, whether we have what it takes, whether we belong here, it affects us to the core of our identity. It can lead us to despair. The flip side of this is that when things go right, when we find our work meaningful, and when it leads to alleviating suffering and healing and saving lives, oh, the joy. Our purpose is fulfilled and our hearts are full. Such is the paradox of veterinary work. How do I know? I used to be a veterinary nurse. I've experienced firsthand the ups and downs of the profession. Fast forward to today. I am now a registered licensed counselor and psychotherapist. I provide support through counseling, therapy, and education to veterinary professionals, and I hear stories just like this. As I reflect on my work as a veterinary nurse, which was over 20 years ago, the idea that veterinary work could impact on well-being was not really acknowledged or discussed. Perhaps I was naive, but I certainly hadn't heard of the concepts of burnout, compassion fatigue, and secondary traumatic stress. The work did, however, at times affect me. It saddened me. It shocked me. It distressed me. And it also frightened me. I didn't talk about it. I thought it was just me. Perhaps back then in the medical profession, the idea that emotions impact working lives was seen as unprofessional and unscientific. Yet it is the emotional connection we feel with animals which draw us into this profession in the first place. Further, what we also know now is that recognizing and managing emotions in clinical practice has real value. The skill enables veterinary professionals to provide compassionate care to clients and patients, and it promotes professional longevity by fostering resilience. This lack of acknowledgement of the emotional toll of veterinary work was widespread. We can even see it in the academic literature. Apart from a handful of studies addressing high rates of suicide in the veterinary profession, it wasn't until the early 2000s that research efforts addressing the mental health issues faced by veterinary professionals significantly increased. More recently, there has been a shift towards investigating factors linked to job satisfaction, resilience, and well-being in the academic literature. We now recognize how the work can be stressful as well as satisfying. Still, I notice a chasm. It exists between what we know about mental health, well-being, and resilience in the academic literature and what those who work in the veterinary profession know, live, and breathe. And this is where Sonja Olson's book truly comes to life. Sonja Olson, an experienced emergency clinician, veterinary mentor, and health and well-being trainer of veterinary teams, shares her wisdom and breadth of experience and knowledge on the topic of well-being and resilience in this book. She also brings to life the voices of her colleagues around the globe. By doing so, she normalizes conversations around vulnerability and mental health. Sonja talks the talk and walks the walk without ego, and will show how you too can have a long and fulfilling professional life, as well as a personal life. This book brings to the listener knowledge and experience that is useful to those studying and practicing the veterinary profession, making it a valuable addition to the libraries of veterinarians, veterinary technicians, nurses, and paraprofessionals. Its value lies in Olson's acknowledgement of the not uncommon imbalance in the journey of becoming a veterinary professional, with its emphasis on clinical skills, striving, precision, and doing in favor of self-care. In the pursuit of this career, and even when we do attain it, we may focus on the next skill, hurry to the next client or the next patient, not stopping to take a breath. We can very quickly lose sight of our 7-year-old self and forget why we are doing what we are doing in the first place. And we forget to be still, a sure recipe for burnout. So as you listen to this book, take it with an open and curious attitude. Listen to the voices of those in your profession. Do not give up, and know that you are not alone. Introduction. In the veterinary caregiving profession, we have got some quote-unquote issues we need to discuss. We have a long-standing culture of perfectionism, of judging ourselves and others, and as a result, a whole lot of shame and unhealthy attitudes. The stigma that we quote-unquote should be smart enough, tough enough, selfless enough to be great veterinarians and technicians right out of the gate from our academic training is ubiquitous. We expect it of ourselves because it was indoctrinated before and during our clinical training. It is then reinforced in the clinical environments that we graduate into as we start to practice. This is the quote-unquote novice professional experience that is well known and written about in human caregiving literature. However, in veterinary medicine, we are just starting to acknowledge and apply the concepts from the human medical research and literature on the quote-unquote occupational hazards of being in a caregiving profession. Such terms as compassion fatigue, vicarious trauma, and moral stressors are a few examples that we are just in the last few years becoming familiar with and applying to what we have been feeling and experiencing in this profession for many decades. In my 25 years as an emergency clinician, veterinary mentor, and supporter of our veterinary teams on Wellbeing, I've experienced the many highs and lows that our profession delivers. The incredible feeling of helping a suffering animal recover and of working like a well-oiled machine with my ER team as we provided high-quality patient care are the highs. Teaching and being taught daily in clinical practice were deeply fulfilling. Yet, like many others, I suffered from the empathic distress, secondary trauma, and burnout that can come from being a deeply empathic caregiver. I personally experienced the fear and feelings of entrapment and the identity crisis of not knowing what to do if I was not, quote-unquote, Dr. Olson, the emergency clinician, in a clinical environment. Through deep work in self-reflection, honesty, and clarifying my values and intentions, I have found my way to a healthier space where I am contributing to our veterinary profession and community in a way that I would not have imagined 10 years ago. I am honored to now be in a novel role that provides well-being support to the amazing veterinary professionals who continue to selflessly give in the veterinary practice environment. Do I miss being on the clinical floor and working with veterinary patients and fellow veterinary colleagues? You bet. Do I feel like I am intellectually less engaged or excited about my professional development? Absolutely not. I have given myself permission to show up as my authentic self and to serve our profession in a way that contributes to my holistic well-being and to those that I support. Throughout those many years, shifts, and roles, I am saddened by the amount of human suffering I have witnessed in the name of selfless caregiving. The unhealthy coping mechanisms that individuals develop, the sacrifice of time for self-care and for family, and the number of individuals who, quote-unquote, burn out and leave this profession honestly breaks my heart. How many might have stayed if given the opportunity to understand how they might have more skillfully navigated the hurdles and pain that led to the decision to leave, or God forbid, to harm themselves? My goal with this book is not to provide a formulaic recipe of how to avoid or to fix these issues. Why not? The honest answer is that this is a far more complex and individualistic journey, Each one of us has to determine the when, the what, and the how to support ourselves as we proceed through our lives. What worked for me may or may not jive with you and your concerns. To that end, it is paramount that we each cultivate a sense of self-awareness, of self-worth, and of self-compassion. We must own our quote-unquote stuff, the good and the rough. It is our responsibility to educate ourselves and become more aware of the occupational hazards related to caregiving. We then have to dedicate ourselves to creating a set of tools and solutions that not only support our improved well-being, but also contribute to the shift in our veterinary culture towards one of honesty, vulnerability, and compassion for ourselves and each other. If you are seeking clarity and the opportunity to build a more quake-proof foundation to build your work-life integration upon, this is where we start. Have the courage to look inward and embrace your imperfect human self with candor and with kindness. We are then better able to allow ourselves to celebrate the amazing, inspirational work that we do to better the lives of animals in all the ways that we do as veterinary professionals every day. This is not a book prescribing solutions or treatment to situations or conditions. Although you will find I reference white papers, books, and research, the primary focus of this book is to create a living narrative told by the amazing veterinary professionals in different seats and in different countries. Whether I reference them directly or not, the experiences and wisdom of these veterinary colleagues are embedded in my perspective and the words I choose here. As much as I had wanted this book to be out in the world last summer, I genuinely believe that it is better now as a result of the knowledge I have gained and the conversations I've had with colleagues over the course of the last year. The personal and professional challenges associated with this year of the COVID-19 pandemic and all of the other unprecedented socioeconomic and political challenges in our respective communities have exhausted us, motivated us, taught us. We are more ready than ever to have the long overdue difficult conversations that will address dysfunctions in so many parts of our lives. Now, I invite you to this honest, open conversation. I believe we can and deserve to have a fulfilling veterinary career and have a life that we love. We are a community that is dedicated to being humane to all beings and to supporting health and longevity. Let's get started on fortifying ourselves and taking a stand for cultivating a professional culture of compassion and collaboration. We belong. We matter. We are more than capable. I believe in us. This is the secret of accompaniment. I will hold a mirror to you and show you your value, bear witness to your suffering and to your light. And over time, you will do the same for me. For within the relationship lies the promise of our shared dignity and the mutual encouragement needed to do the hard things. Quote by Jacqueline Novogratz, Manifesto for a Moral Revolution. Chapter 1, The Evolution of the Veterinary Profession. How did we get here? If you don't know where you are going, you'll end up someplace else. Quote by Yogi Berra. Our shared history. The historic cultural expectations and ways of working in the veterinary field have created a system that is resulting in burned out caregivers who either leave the profession or disengage from their lives. By examining the high cost to us as veterinary professionals, we can speak the truth of what is no longer serving us as a profession and collaborate on solutions to create a healthier culture and more professional systems. Ultimately, we need to have a deeper understanding of our profession and ourselves to work towards sustainable solutions that will allow us to experience more joy and thrive as caregiving individuals and professionals. As such, we need to have a clear sense of how we arrived where we are today as a profession. To set the stage for this book's story, I begin with a historical perspective of our complex veterinary profession culture. It is interesting and valuable to consider the evolution of the relationship between humans and animals in their care. Here, I present a high-level overview of the history and evolution of veterinary medicine to lay down a foundation. Although there are some veterinary fields of medicine that have maintained a more traditional relationship between caregivers and the animals in their care, think production animal medicine, there are other fields that have changed significantly, such as companion animal medicine. This has resulted in a different set of expectations of the veterinary caregiver from the owner, guardian of the animal. Prior to delving further into these more specific and modern topics around the human-animal bond, I want to take a moment to step back and share the broader historical view of the veterinary profession. Quote-unquote trivial pursuit time. Did you know that the word veterinary comes from the Latin veterinae, meaning quote-unquote working animals, and that the word veterinarian was first used in print by Thomas Brown in 1646? Take a moment to geek out with me and listen to the provided timeline, which depicts our long-standing global relationship with animals. Global timeline of veterinary medicine. 3000 BC, Mesopotamia. The Mesopotamian Urlagadina, named as expert in healing animals. 2500 BC, China. Veterinary treaties on horses and cattle. 2200 BC, Babylonia. Code of Hammurabi outlines veterinary fees. 1800 BC, India. Salihotra named veterinarian of horses. 400 BC, Greece. Hippocrates, quote-unquote, humoral pathology affects veterinary practice for 2,000 years. 250 BC, India. Kin Asoka constructs veterinary hospitals. 70 BC, Rome. Vero treatise indicates a veterinary professional class. 330 AD, Byzantium. Absyrtus called, quote-unquote, father of veterinary medicine. 450 AD, Rome. Vegetius' books on veterinary art, influential for years. 900 AD, England, Anglo-Saxon leech book includes animal cures. 1350 AD, Italy, Lawrence Roussius Hippiatra, widely circulated in printed editions after 1530. 1490 AD, Spain, short-lived veterinary schools established. 1522, Spain, Francisco de la Reina, Book of Veterinary. 1528, Switzerland, Vegetius' work printed as Mula Medicina. 1565 AD, England, Thomas Blundville, first major English veterinary book on horses. 1576, England, George Tuberville, first English book dealing with diseases of dogs. 1598, Italy, Carlo Ruini, first anatomy of the horse, prefacing the start of veterinary science. 1639, England, Thomas D. Gray, book on horses, hereditary disease, and attempted rationale for common procedures. 1664 AD, France. Jacques de Soiselle wrote classic text, Recognized Glanders. 1683 Scotland, Andrew Snape, first English equine anatomy book. 1711 Italy and England, Giovanni Lasky and Thomas Bates both established effective methods to control rinderpest, but was not used. 1720 England, William Gibson Farrier advances humane treatment, rational medication, and education. 1761 France, Claude Bourgelat founded Lyon Veterinary School and Alfort School in 1765, quote unquote, the start of the veterinary profession. 1783 England, Francis Clatter, Every Man His Own Farrier, the first of his many horse doctor books. 1785 England, Oldham Agricultural Society proposes British Veterinary School. 1791 England, London Veterinary College founded with Sen Bell as first professor. Start of the British veterinary profession. Early 19th century, United States. First veterinary schools established in Boston, New York, and Philadelphia. 1863 United States, American Veterinary Medical Association founded. 1879 Iowa, USA. Iowa Agricultural College became the first land-grant school to establish a school of veterinary medicine. 1965, United States, FDA added a veterinary medical branch to oversee veterinary pharmaceuticals, later became the Center for Veterinary Medicine. Modern-day definition of veterinary medicine in Wikipedia, 2020. Prevention, control, diagnosis, and treatment of disease, disorder, and injury in animals. Also deals with animal rearing, husbandry, breeding, and research on nutrition and product development. The wide scope of veterinary medicine covers all animal species, both domesticated and wild. veterinary science helps human health through the monitoring and control of zoonotic diseases, food safety, and indirectly, human applications from basic medical research. Veterinary medicine and science also maintain the human food supply through livestock health monitoring and treatment, keeping pets healthy and long-living. Veterinary scientists often collaborate with epidemiologists and other health and natural scientists. Example, the Global One Health Initiative, a concept that describes the wellness of humans, animals, and the environment as permanently tied together. Veterinary medicine and the state of the profession directly correlates with the ever-evolving relationships that humans have with animals. Regarding domesticated animals, there were initially practical reasons for interest in their health. Animals have provided protection and service to humans for more than 15,000 years. These services range from providing food, supporting farming and hunting, and reducing the vermin populations in barns, which decreases transmission of disease and damage to food or other materials. A historic example is the horse, a primary focus of veterinary medical care for over the last 2,000 years, as they have been economically important for transportation, agriculture, and trade. As human medicine and understanding of disease and pathology progressed, so did veterinary medicine. The concepts were applied to farm animals first in the 1700s. The anatomy and diseases of horses, cattle, and sheep were studied with great interest due to the animal's importance to the agrarian economy. Veterinarians were largely called upon to care for livestock, particularly horses, due to military and agricultural needs. Over the last 100 years, there have been tremendous shifts in veterinary medicine. It was only in the early 1900s that domesticated animals such as dogs, cats, and exotic pocket pets, example rabbits and guinea pigs, came to be viewed more as pets, and as a result, received more regular medical care and improved nutrition. Particularly over the last 40 years, the small animal veterinary medicine community's focus expanded to include domesticated animals that were increasingly seen as family members, although they may still have their jobs of being guard or herding dogs or vermin control cats. The advent of improved parasite control, both GI parasites and ectoparasites such as fleas and ticks, supported this transition of animals from the yards and barns into our homes. The human-animal bond of today. As the human-animal bond has evolved over the 20th and 21st centuries, so have opportunities and challenges for veterinary professionals. It is exciting to have so many more diagnostic and therapeutic options available for veterinary patients, as well as an increased desire in many parts of the world to seek out and accept veterinary professional expertise and care. However, the flip side of this coin is that there are more fraught emotional obstacle courses that the veterinary caregivers must navigate with animal caretakers. Although your thinking may go immediately to a scenario that involves a much-loved, quote-unquote, furry kid in a client's home, there are other less obvious areas where emotions can run high, such as in zoo and wildlife conservation medicine. Recently, in some circles, the term, quote-unquote, guardian is used instead of, quote, pet parent, to curb the anthropomorphizing of the relationship between animals and their caretakers and mitigate the confusing, emotionally charged landscape. All this matters because it impacts how veterinary caregivers are perceived by the animal's quote-unquote guardians, how we perceive ourselves, how monies are invested, or not, in animal care, and the creation of laws to protect animal welfare and rights. American Veterinary Medical Association definition of the human-animal bond is, the human-animal bond is a mutually beneficial and dynamic relationship between people and animals that is influenced by behaviors essential to the health and well-being of both. This includes, among other things, emotional, psychological, and physical interactions of people, animals, and the environment. The veterinarian's role in the human-animal bond is to maximize the potentials of this relationship between people and animals. The AVMA recognizes, 1, the existence of the human-animal bond and its importance to client and community health. 2, that the human-animal bond has existed for thousands of years. 3, that the human-animal bond has major significance for veterinary medicine because as veterinary medicine serves society, it fulfills both human and animal needs. Note, Human-Animal Bond Certification Program offered through the Human-Animal Bond Research Institute, HABRI, and the North American Veterinary Community, NAVC. There is no doubt that the way we care for veterinary patients, particularly those seen as family members, has drastically changed over the last 30 to 40 years. Owners have more information, thank you, Dr. Gould, and often wish to have a more active role in their pet's care. The thought process has also evolved from what would have been done for a working dog or a barn cat in the past to what type of care would I want for a member of my family? This humanizing of care for veterinary patients has allowed for remarkable advances in the types of care that can be provided today. More and more pets are considered part of the family. Some go so far as to refer to their pets as quote-unquote furry kids and to themselves as quote-unquote pet parents rather than owners or guardians. We know that these evolving attitudes about animals and their status have also prompted changes in how we view wellness care, which now includes dental cleanings, grooming, and an alternative treatment such as naturopathic medicine and acupuncture. Services such as mobile veterinary medicine and hospice care have also grown from the desire to minimize stress and maximize care for both the veterinary patient and the animal guardian. A poignant example of the evolving relationship of humans and their animal family members is when cancer is part of a differential diagnosis for a malady. According to the Animal Cancer Foundation's website, acfoundation.org, an estimated 65 million dogs and 32 million cats live in the United States. Of these, roughly 6 million new cancer diagnoses are made in both dogs and cats each year based on the data from the National Cancer Institute of NIH in a 2017 article. That neoplasia that is being referenced may be either benign or malignant overgrowth of cells or tissues. Historically, a cancer diagnosis would have led to a conversation about palliative therapy and preparation for humane euthanasia to minimize suffering of the animal. Today, veterinary professionals have access to quite a few of the same diagnostics and therapeutics for the treatment of pets that up until recently were only used to treat people with cancer and other maladies. Importantly, not all owners are in the position to pursue these options, but the fact that we are at the stage in the human-pet relationship where many owners are asking to discuss these options and may pursue them is remarkable. Certainly, ongoing research over the last several decades has demonstrated that human caregivers are benefiting from the relationship with animals as well. For example, people living with dogs are 15% less likely to die from heart disease as stress levels are reduced, and caregivers enjoy increased activity levels from caring for and exercising the pet. We have also learned that owning and caring for pets can lower blood pressure and raise blood oxytocin levels, which are helpful for all humans, not just those with the potential for cardiomyopathies. Interacting with companion animals and elderly patients and with children can provide significant emotional, social, cognitive, and behavioral support. For all, owning a pet can also provide pet owners with a purpose, which supports overall well-being. There are people who do have a genuinely deep emotional attachment to their animals. The general population may not be as influenced by this outlook as we are. Are the animals benefiting as much from this bond as the humans do? If a medical concern is impacting the client, it becomes more likely that the pet will be brought in to see a veterinarian for evaluation and care in a timely manner. Think of the puppy with persistent diarrhea soiling the floors and furniture and wanting to go outside every 5 minutes. Or the itchy dog that keeps his owners up all night with persistent scratching of his ears. Would that same pet be seen for comfort and appropriate medical therapy if it was not inconveniencing the pet owner? I recognize my own bias around this. Quote, have the pet seen now because it is bothering me, the client, unquote, as I've helped many the pet and client during ER hours over the 20 plus years that I was in clinical practice. However, I know that in speaking to colleagues in all veterinary segments then and now, this is a phenomenon that exists as part of the veterinary medicine. I bring it up here as a situation that can evoke conflicting feelings for the veterinary care team. Is it really an emergency medical concern or a convenience visit for itchy ears at 3 a.m.? The team is glad for the opportunity to care for the pet regardless of the hour, but why did the owner choose now? The last question can get emotionally sticky when it involves a more serious medical concern, such as a mammary mass that has been progressively enlarging for months, but now has ruptured and is bleeding, and the mess in the house finally led the owner to have the pet evaluated. Morally distressing for the care team? Absolutely. There are other factors that may impact when or if a pet is seen regularly for wellness visits or is seen for a medical issue. Examples may include differences in perspective of the relationship that the pet has with the family, financial constraints, or beliefs in how much is, quote unquote, reasonable to invest in the care of an animal, as well as variances in religious and cultural beliefs. In the veterinary caregivers' minds, there are pets that receive what many would consider the bare minimum of ethical care. By law, an animal is deemed to be, quote unquote, reasonably cared for if food, water, and shelter are provided, even if each of these is in questionable quality and amount. It can be morally distressing to the veterinary professional to be the one that cares for the animal more than the owner appears to care. As veterinary caregivers, we are the advocates for the animal patients and their well-being. We will come back to this complex topic later in the book when we discuss ethical conflicts and moral stressors as contributors to veterinary caregiver burnout. One caregiving approach, or way of thinking, does not fit all. As we examine the human-animal bond further, we also recognize that the relationship between humans and the animals that they care for can vary widely based on the role the animal may have in the human guardian's life. In conjunction, the veterinary caretaker's professional involvement in the animal's care can be, and will often be, associated with the sector of veterinary medicine within which they practice. Consider for a moment what you believe the relationship to be between veterinary caregivers and the animal patients to be in the following veterinary environments: companion animal veterinary medicine, equine medicine, example, race horses, show horses, hobby farms, food animal production, example, dairy, poultry, meat, military police canine officers, zoo wildlife conservation medicine, laboratory research medicine. Like you, I have my own opinions based on my life and professional experience to date. Additionally, in my years preceding veterinary school and in the 26 years since veterinary school graduation, I've had the pleasure to know many veterinary caregivers in each of these different veterinary caregiving positions. With those perspectives in mind, let's very briefly examine some of the unique relationships between animals and their guardians in different veterinary segments. Companion animal medicine. Cats, dogs, birds, small mammals, reptiles. Clients in this veterinary segment are more likely to have an expectation for these animals to be treated like human family members and resultantly may have a high emotional attachment. However, this may or may not translate into a willingness to invest financially in the animal's care and well-being. Quote from Dr. Teresa Lightfoot, DABVP in Avian Exotics, well known as a clinician instructor, speaker, and author around the care of exotic pets. She stated that, quote, after 35 years of practice and rationalizations that go along with that, unquote, she had a few important takeaways. Quote, the most important revelation I had was that pet owners just do not want to feel guilty. When presented with a recommended diagnostic and treatment plan that is way out of their budget, they feel awkward, guilty, and then often angry. Working into the conversation early, quote, I know this might not be practical for you. You have a family to take care of, end quote, almost immediately removed the unspoken barrier between us of financial concerns versus being a good owner, and allowed us to work together to form a plan. Quote from Dr. Karen Fine, a small animal integrative medicine practitioner, who has also practiced for several decades, shared, when it comes to supporting a family around financial constraints, she helps them massage the guilt that may arise by sharing, quote, that there's the ideal world and there's the real world, end quote. I found myself saying something along those lines myself many, many times in the ER medicine realm. Equine medicine surgery. The personal stories I have heard from equine practitioners offered contrasting perspectives on the pros and cons of this type of veterinary work. The patient care itself can be physically demanding, and in many instances, the veterinarian may be seeing the patient by her or himself without technician assistance. The circumstances under which care is provided also vary depending upon whether the patient is out in a paddock, in the barn, or in a physical hospital offering more infrastructure and caregiving support to the veterinary team. It is not unusual to hear that some horse owners can be slow to seek veterinary care, as many remedies will be tried by the owners themselves first before reaching out to the vet. These owners can be quite suspicious of veterinarian care, and they may try therapies that the horse-owning community, quote-unquote, knows to do first, and only contact the veterinarian if the medical issue does not resolve or worsens. The flip side of this approach can be seen with racehorses, which are very expensive and cared for at the highest level. These animals have veterinary caregivers who may be on call 24/7, or may even live on the premises to care for the animals. There are, of course, many, many horse owners that fall in between these two ends of the caregiving spectrum who work in tandem with their veterinary care team to ensure that proactive wellness and nutrition regimens are provided. Food animal production. This is such an incredibly varied patient population: cattle, pigs, sheep, goats, poultry. The caregivers can have equally diverse relationships with these animals. The guardians of these animals may be less likely to have a close emotional bond to individual animals, but there is the prevalence of an ethical responsibility to have the DABVP animals lead healthy lives. Economic influences the preventative care and overall management of the herd or flock. It also benefits the human consumer to have veterinarians involved in the design and implementation of healthcare protocols for these animals. Quote from Dr. Mike Andrizi, graduated from The Ohio State University in 1977 as a second-generation veterinarian in his family. He elected to practice mixed animal medicine for more than 17 years. He felt that when he graduated into his job in the veterinary profession, he and his professional peers felt they had the quote-unquote best job. He enjoyed having work that provided case variety, intellectual challenges, the opportunity to build relationships with the owners, farmers, and the ability to grow and learn throughout the years of practice. Military police dogs. These special canine patients are cared for by both civilian and military veterinarians. A large amount of time and money is invested in the training of these animals. These dogs are often seen as protectors and partners, and as such are highly respected and provided top care by their handlers and the others on the team. In the years following my internship, I practiced small animal ER medicine in Alexandria, Virginia, just outside of Washington, D.C. It was an honor and privilege to provide emergency care to the canine officers of the Alexandria Police Force, as well as those from the Army base at Fort Belvoir. As an example, when the Pentagon was attacked on September 11, 2001, I was part of one of many veterinary teams that cared for the rescue dogs that day and for the week following. I witnessed firsthand the depth of the emotional relationship and the respect held for these dogs by their handlers. Zoo wildlife medicine. The patient populations of zoos, wildlife parks, and conservation management facilities certainly vary enormously, as do their unique husbandry and medical concerns. What is not known or seen by the public are the often challenging and sometimes conflicting priorities between boards of directors, veterinary caregivers, keepers, and conservationists. If the animals are rare or endangered, such as snow leopards, or have been part of a collection for a long time, example, gorillas, there's a very strong feeling of responsibility to do everything possible to care for these animals. Financial support can vary too, depending upon the facility, the patient or patients being cared for, and the concern around public perception of the animal's well-being. This is a far more political and complex realm of veterinary medicine than those outside of it could possibly know. In 1998, Disney's Animal Kingdom in Florida opened. Several papers and news outlets reported about the 31 animals that died at the park in the months before its opening. The USDA was involved in the investigation of the animal deaths. The federal report that was released said the animals died from accidents, poisonings, accidental toxicities due to plants and other substances found in the enclosures, fighting, and other forms of trauma, fence entanglements, or injuries from other animals. I remember at the time hearing about this as well from veterinary colleagues that worked at the National Zoo in Washington, D.C., where I had volunteered for 10 years. It was enormously distressing to the keepers and the veterinarians to hear about the deaths of these animals. But even more so was how the Disney animal caregivers were being accused and treated by public and animal rights groups. Just an example of how the care and the death of these animals have been in the public eye long before the influence of the various social media that impact veterinary teams today. Laboratory research animals. Here again, the patient population is quite varied, as are the environments under which care is provided. Over the last several decades, regulations, performance-based standards, and animal welfare have positively impacted research designs, protocols for care, and how animals can be used in research. Housing, nutrition, environmental enrichment, and consideration of animal welfare have all changed for the better as a result. The research done in these environments continue to play an enormously important role in furthering understanding of both human medicine, veterinary medicine, and One Health initiatives. While speaking to my colleague, Dr. Dondre Coble, he offered many insights from his numerous years in laboratory medicine, research, and teaching, such as the aforesaid improvements in lab animal care. When I inquired about the unique stressors for caregivers in these environments, he shared that work-life integration and creation of healthy workspaces for the professionals are as important in these environments as in any practice. Additionally, employee wellness programs are imperative in these environments, as concerns such as compassion fatigue are evident in these caregivers. Understanding our past and clarifying our present experiences. In speaking to veterinary assistants, technicians, practice managers, and clinicians who practiced in the 80s and 90s, terms such as compassion fatigue, moral stressors, burnout were not known or applied to the work-related experiences of veterinary professionals. With a current understanding of these terms, many of these individuals can appreciate in retrospect that they did in fact experience some of these conditions to a degree, or a lot, when they were in practice. Those individuals that have been practicing since the late 1990s, including myself, have had the opportunity to witness firsthand changes in the veterinary landscape for the better and for the worse. As we examine the past, current, and future dynamics of veterinary practice and the impact on veterinary caregivers, there is wisdom in borrowing from existing learning from our human medicine colleagues. There exists abundant research and evolving strategies in human caregiving fields that can directly apply to veterinary medicine on how to practice high-quality medicine, maintain empathy and compassion, and not sacrifice mental and physical well-being along the way. To wrap up the quote-unquote, how did we get here idea, meaning how veterinary medicine has changed in the last 30 to 40 years to what it is today, with today's stressors and joys for veterinary professionals, let's hear from some veterinary colleagues. Each of these uniquely wonderful individuals shared how different things were for them when they first went out into clinical practice. Different expectations of themselves, different client expectations, different relationships between the clients and the pets and animals. There was no social media, internet for a better part of their careers. And referral specialty medicine was still primarily in the universities, not in private practice. These are their perspectives. Julia Jones, Small Animal General Practitioner, Florida. Each generation has challenges. Time organization has been my biggest challenge, but personal relationships have been my greatest source of reward. Our class of 1985 started out with the standard texts, classic journals, class notes, information gathered from colleagues and referral specialists, working crazy hours, sleeping at the clinic overnight, or taking animals home on IVs. Emergency clinics were in their nascency, and the nearest referral practices were often universities. Internet access was only for the professors. We now have access to more information at the touch of a finger, more specialists, and more emergency ICU practices. One would think it improves time management. Standards of care have changed. Costs have changed. Legal challenges and regulations have changed. Veterinary-driven continuing education has shifted to industry. Sheer volume of available information has changed. With that comes the compartmentalization of veterinary care, as it has for human medicine. In our effort to keep up, deliver care, see more patients, afford the cost of running a practice, and maintain our sanity, we have tried to restrict access to our time by more referrals. We are in danger of losing our personal relationships with the client if we are not careful. That quote-unquote thing that makes us special with people because of our love of animals and the compassion we show them is precious. This has been what sets us apart from the other health professions. My biggest advice to young veterinarians is to give more guidance to pet owners as they look to you for help in making decisions and not just throw a bunch of differentials and choices in their laps. Know the pet's name and the owner's name when you walk in the room. Listen and guide the conversation. Take interest in the outcome. Call them. It is amazing how much that binds them to you and the practice and increases the personal reward. Susan Hazel, Senior Lecturer, University of Adelaide, Australia. I graduated in 1987 when my experiences as a student and veterinarian were the same but different. As a graduate veterinarian, the challenges in moving from student to veterinarian were the same as for students today. Not feeling that you knew enough initially, but learning every day so the next case was easier. Feeling the full impact when animals had to be euthanized and owners comforted. The main difference is the internet, social media amplifying mistakes and successes, and pressures of time and economics. I've moved to an academic role and the students are amazing, but the pressures of working and studying seem worse. We had a few textbooks and lecture notes to study. Now, lecture slides, papers, books, and the internet mean information is limitless. Veterinary care is still about maximizing welfare for animals. We need to do this while protecting the welfare of veterinarians. Michael Scher, practicing critical care medicine since the 1980s and still on faculty with the University of Florida Veterinary Teaching Hospital. My impressions now span 51 years of veterinary medicine. I find that the profession has been blessed with many bright minds over the years, and I'm glad to say that this trend has continued over the entire time period. I know some have stated that the new generation is spoiled and wants things handed to them on a platter, but I find that the majority of my students have consistently met the educational challenges and that my graduates are better trained than ever before when they cross that stage to receive their diplomas. I find that today's graduate is much more adept with the various technologies, but this has come, in some cases, at the expense of adhering to the basics when addressing the sick animal. They are the product of the education that is practiced in the teaching hospital. If they see clinicians jumping right into AFAST before they complete a detailed physical examination, then we are failing them right from the starting line by their failure to routinely do thorough abdominal palpations and other basic maneuvers, including rectal examinations and fundic examinations. There are some schools that have increased their caseloads to the point of forcing some clinicians to the point of not spending enough personal time to take thorough histories, which turn out to be very different than what is abstracted by a third party. I witness this to the present day, which ends up costing more time, money, and possibly harm. We should not abandon the teachings of Sir William Osler, who taught that, quote, medicine begins with a patient, continues with a patient, and ends with a patient, end quote. Ken Drobatz, practicing ER and critical care medicine since the 1980s, clinical faculty and instructor at the University of Pennsylvania Veterinary School and Teaching Hospital. Rapid and huge development in the sophistication of veterinary medicine. The development of information technology and how it has sped up research and communication in veterinary medicine. The explosion of veterinary specialists and specialty hospitals. The massive increase in the costs of veterinary education and its impact on new veterinarians. The massive increase in the cost of veterinary medicine to our clients. The initially gradual but now rapidly increased corporate ownership of vet hospitals. All of this could be contributing to the loss of the quote-unquote soul of veterinary medicine that it once had with its personal relationships and interactions with our clientele. Laura Busher, DVM, and also known as Nana by her human family, practiced small animal medicine over 33 years of her clinical career with a few farm animals sprinkled in for quote-unquote entertainment. She owned her own practice as a solo doctor in a rural setting, was a relief veterinarian, a veterinary recruiter, and practiced in a large 50-doctor GP specialty hospital before landing in her current role as a practitioner. How do we get here and where do we want to go? Winnie the Pooh says, quote, "I always get where I am going by walking away from where I have been," end quote. We got here by grit. In a time when many said we couldn't, we simply kept doing. We did, despite gender, marital status, or having children. To move forward, we must knit ourselves together with our common passions and support each other's differences. I see women trying to define, confine women by a role that excludes other women. The more we include others, the better we will all be as individuals. Janice Massaro, technician at University of Florida Veterinary Teaching Hospital for 10-plus years, before moving into a veterinary practice manager role with an equine specialty practice for 17 years, now in clinician recruiting role for small animal ER specialty practices in a corporate group. Having been in the veterinary industry since 1991, I have seen a lot of changes over the years. When I started as a vet technician, as head of internal medicine service at one of the nation's top vet schools, I had no idea this would lead me to 30 years in this amazing profession. When starting out in the 90s, we had no personal cell phones, no social media, and we, 25 vet techs, were closely as a team. We all had much respect for each other and would do anything to help our teammates. I attribute our success to our amazing vet tech manager, who not only worked with us, she appreciated everything we did. My career took me to the management position, 1998 to 2015. A day didn't pass without me telling my 35 technicians how amazing they were. This was key for retention. In 2015, I became a recruiter. I now watch as social media, lack of support and appreciation, and exhaustion drive our veterinarians to depression and likely the need to leave their occupation from where they have dedicated most of their adult lives. I am hoping appreciation for all employees of the veterinary profession finds its way back. I truly believe thankfulness has become a thing of the past. It is what keeps us going. First and foremost, pay attention to the people you work with. Thank them and help them out every chance you get. Be visible, be warm, and tell them how important they are.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.